Hi, and welcome to today's webinar. I'm Mike Swanson on behalf of the Law Practice Channel. I'm speaking to you from my home with the COVID lockdown near Nashville, Tennessee. And I think you're really going to enjoy today's webinar. Before we get started, just real quick, this is me. I am the CEO and chairman of Advocate Capital and author of How David Beats Goliath. It's the only finance training book ever written to help plaintiff lawyers. If you'd like a copy, message me. I'm happy to send you a copy. And today's webinar is brought to you by Advocate Capital. We are the purveyors of the AvoTrack Case Expense Funding Service. Quick disclaimer, this information today is just for your own use and consideration. Always consult your independent legal or accounting representatives if you're going to be making any important decisions based on what you hear today. So without further ado, Mitch Jackson will be joining us live from Aliso Viejo in Orange County, and we should see him pop up in a moment or two. He is a senior partner and founding member of Attorney at Law of the Jackson and Wilson trial law firm. He is also known as the Live Video Lawyer. We'll hear more about that, and he's won several awards around the country. Mitch, hello. Thanks for joining us.
Mike, thanks for having me on today. This is going to be fun. I want a copy of your book, by the way.
Oh, sure. Absolutely. Amanda will make sure that we get you a copy of that. I'll even autograph.
I appreciate that. I appreciate that.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, it's good to see you, Mitch. I've known about you for many years and known you somewhat through social media for a while as well. And so it's great to have you here with us. I'm going to get you larger on the screen by taking that slide down.
And sounds good. You don't want to make me too big, okay? I mean, we don't want to shock anybody here. But, you know, it's interesting because I feel like I know you also, and that's from the digital platforms, which is why I'm so excited to be on today's show. This is such a powerful tool for lawyers.
Yeah, it's incredible. Yeah. I didn't get on the social media until 2011, right after I wrote the book. One of my friends said, you got to start blogging, and you got to get on social media. I'm like, Facebook, that's for my kids or whatever. It has been such a strong way to connect with people. I'm sure, like you, I'll be at a trade show, and someone walk over and act like they know me because they've watched videos and what have you. So it's a very powerful way of connecting.
Absolutely. I mean, just sitting in the courthouse waiting for a jury to come back from lunch to walk into the courtroom, I'll have young lawyers walk up and introduce themselves, and they'll talk about a video I've shared, or they'll talk about that verdict that we obtained. And so it's been a great way to build new relationships and really add value to existing relationships. And with COVID-19 right now, I think a lot of lawyers are appreciating the importance of relationships and using social media to build them out. So that's one reason I jumped on the chance to be on today's show. This is a game changer, what we're doing. And I want to see more lawyers, engage on social and embrace social and use social to build relationships. And at the end, bring in new clients to help more people.
Yeah, I think this reminds me of, I've been in this industry for 21 years. And in the beginning, I would go to trade association meetings and someone would raise their hand and say, should I have a website? They'd argue, you don't need a website. You just need the yellow pages, right? So now, do I need to know how to use Zoom? Yeah, I think you do.
Yeah, and for those lawyers that have already embraced live video, like you, I started using video and live video back in 2012 with a company called Spreecast. Jeff Floor was the co-founder of StubHub. Once he sold that, he then backed out and a couple of years later realized we needed live video and social media. And so I was all in early, and immediately after being on shows with like Anderson Cooper, Katie Kirk, Peter Diamandis, I realized I would not have met these people had it not been for live video. And of course, when it comes to branding you and branding your practice, it was something that I've never experienced before. And you're talking to somebody, Mike, who threw up their first website in 1996. When you use the Wayback Machine and you type in a website address, I think we were on earlier than 96, but you'll find our websites from 96. And I remember about 8 months after putting up a website, probably one of the first lawyers to have a website, at least here in California, we had a seven-figure case come in. And I've never been accused of being the sharpest knife in the drawer, but when that happened, I thought to myself, you know what, this internet thing, maybe there's something to it. And I think when you add social media and some of the things that we're going to be talking about today, it's like throwing gasoline on a fire. The sky's the limit.
Yeah, I can't overstate the value of live video, or at least video. I think people want to do business with people, right? Not a corporation or a faceless law firm or something like that. And that's been my experience anyway. When we made the decision to put me out in front of the business and start using video, it really, because our growth exploded. So I'm not taking credit from my ugly mug. I have a face for radio, obviously. But it's the power of the human connection.
And it's a two-edged sword. And so that's one reason I wanted to come on today is live video is a two-edged sword. If you go about it the right way, and it's not hard, it's not complicated, this isn't rocket science, but if you go about it the right way, you can build your brand, you can help more people, you can, instead of that one-to-one that when I started practicing in 1986 with a client, 86 with a client across my desk, answering questions, now it's 1 to 100, 1 to 1,000. I've had some shows where it's 1 to 20,000, right? Wow, and you can help more. You can help more people sleep better at night by sharing legal solutions, by sharing your secret sauce. On the other side of the coin, Mike, what I've seen are lawyers and other professionals that just jump on social media, they jump on a live video, and they don't think it through. They've got the dirty dishes in the back, even though we're all working from home right now. You know, take a little bit of time, worry about your background, learn how to look at the webcam, which is what I'm doing right now, as opposed to looking over at Michael on the screen. These simple tricks help you be more effective with live video and connect with your audience. So those are two of my top tips right there for live video. And I just want to see lawyers, when they're trying to help the consumer, go about the whole process the right way. And once again, it's not complicated. Once you share these tips with the lawyers, they're smart, they get it, they pick it up, and they're better than most pros out there.
Let's talk about backgrounds for a moment. So you and I have taken a different approach today. I was using virtual backgrounds, but today I'm actually standing in front of a bookcase. It's a real bookcase. These are my kids, or my daughter, Blim, things like that. Awesome. But tell our viewers about virtual backgrounds. I'm not sure everybody knows about that.
Sure. So I'm a big fan of having my law firm, my office, just like you, in the background. I'm home right now. I'm not at the office. And so what we've done is we're using a green screen virtual background. But let me show you guys something. Hang on a second. Blur. So when you come off the elevator at our office, this is the third floor. We're on the third and fourth floors. You'll come off, and this is a picture of our office. So clients, when they see me online, they'll say, you know, this, yeah, I feel like I've been here before, or I remember watching you broadcast from the lobby of your office. So I think strategically using backgrounds, whether it's the background that you're using, whether it's the background that I'm using, I think it helps with that initial first impression. And something that trial lawyers have known for a long time, Mike, and I know you know this, but think about this, you guys, when you jump on social media, when you jump on live video, traditionally you have about 4 minutes to create an initial first impression. And if you take the time with having the right background, with having an ironed shirt, with having something to say that's specific, unique, memorable, something that adds value to your audience, you're going to leave a good first impression with, once again, your audience of one or your live and recorded audience. And I think all of these things come into play, and it starts with how you look, what your background is, what's the quality of your broadcast, the quality of your service, and the ability to interact back and forth with your audience, to have good people skills. And just real quick, because I'm in a different screen and I want to show you something, you know, How to Win Friends and Influence People, written in the 1930s by Dale Carnegie.
I love
this
book.
I do too. And this book is more applicable and relevant today than ever before. But the reason I'm sharing it with you right now is it happens to be on my screen. And I want to show everyone how easy it is to bring something into your video feed to help make it a little bit more interesting, to help make it a little more memorable, to give people a reason to want to share what you're doing. When I mentor young trial lawyers, Mike, I will not spend any more time with them until they've read this book by Bob Berg, who's the co-author of the Go Giver series, Adversaries into Allies. It's one of the best people, it's the best people skills book I've ever read. And it shows young, it shows everyone, but for me, trial lawyers, how to understand the ego systems and the belief systems and first impressions with their audience. But the reason I'm bringing that up right now is just to show your audience how you can quickly and easily bring other things onto the screen to keep the conversation going and to keep things interesting.
I love this. I knew I'd learn stuff today. This is awesome. So I got to back you up a little bit. And we've been using virtual backgrounds in Zoom, right? But we're using GoToWebinar right now. And I don't know how you're doing. There's a software you're using, or how are you doing that? Can you tell our viewers how to do it?
There is. And believe me, everything I do, Mike, super simple. Okay. That's my secret to success.
Good.
So what I use is Ecamm, E-C-A-M-M. And the reason I use Ecamm is it allows me to record traditional video to my laptop or desktop and share it all over social media. It also allows me to click a button and create what's called a virtual cam. What happened is when I go live on Zoom or on this platform or BombBomb, which is one of my favorite video email forms, it's a game changer, you guys, so we can talk about it. It allows me to select that virtual cam as the camera source.
Nice.
All right. And so instead of me right now broadcasting, we have a downstairs home office, which is a traditional wood office, something like what you have, but family's down there right now. So now I'm upstairs in our new upstairs bonus room office, which used to be just the bonus room. And this allows me, instead of having white wooden shutters behind me, which isn't really the impression I want to give someone, to have that first impression so that when someone comes to our office, they're going to feel like they've been there and it just works. So I use Ecamm.
Use that. Yeah, I can't wait to get that and use that for my next webinar because, you know, I'm standing in front of a bookcase and it's not all that comfortable. So I'll be able to have my virtual background anywhere I want.
So if I was consulting you, which I'm not, but if I was, I'd say I love your background, Mike. I think it looks, I think what it does is it reflects the human side of who you are, your family, your hobbies, your interests, what's important to you in your life. I absolutely wouldn't change a thing with your background. Okay. And but it just kind of depends on where you are. Consistency on social media is very important. You want to be consistent, whether you're sharing content, it's how you engage with your clients or your audience. And for me, when it comes to video, I want to be consistent with what the audience sees in the background. You know, you'll see before COVID-19 hit, I'm always shooting video from the beach during a run. Right? And people get to know me as that lawyer that's out for a run using his GoPro or using his phone. This right here, you guys. This is a game changer. We're all production companies in today's world. So, you know, now that we are social distancing and trying to stay home here in Southern California, I am not one of those people out on the beach right now. I want to create a consistent experience for the viewer. And so that's why we're using green screens.
Yeah. So I've seen your videos when you're on location, sometimes you're on vacation with the family or wherever you might be. It's kind of cool. We get to ride along with you. Any so tips on a GoPro versus an iPhone or any techniques you use in that?
I think the biggest tip is, once again, to keep things simple. 99% of what you need to do, you can do with your smartphone. And when lawyers start to overcomplicate the process, I think what happens is they stop creating content and they start overthinking the quality of what it is they need to create and put out there. I'm a big believer in lawyers sharing their human side and showing their human side. Figure out what your hobbies, your passions, your interests are, and then give yourself permission to create content around those hobbies and interests and passions. Give yourself permission to have a voice and share the human side of what you do. You can do that with a smartphone. The reason I like running with my GoPro is it's got a digital stabilizer built in, and it's a silky smooth recorded video of a run or, you know, of a paddleboard experience that works real well, but it's not real time. For those lawyers, Mike, that want to do what we're doing right now and create live videos or recorded videos from their home office or even from their office, the setup I have here at home is identical to what we have at the office in a video conference room. And here's the secret. What you need is you need good audio. That's number one. I would encourage everyone to invest in some type of good USB microphone, you guys, because audio is everything when it comes to creating video, number one. Number two, think about your light sources. Have a three-point lighting system, 45 degrees, 45 degrees, and then a round glamour light or whatever you want to call it, about four feet away in front of me. And I'm using a Logitech webcam on top of my desktop computer screen, which works just fine. This setup allows me to go live in about 15 seconds of preparation. And I think that's key for lawyers, especially busy lawyers, creating content and getting content out the door and onto the digital platforms.
Yeah, I'm a student of lighting. I used to want to be a photographer in my 20s. I actually did it for a little while and didn't want to do weddings every Saturday for the rest of my life. So I went a different direction. But so many people, you see them on webcam, and there's a ceiling fan right behind them because it's pointing up at their ceiling, and their face is dark because they all have an open window behind them and things like that. So I'm glad you mentioned. I was going to say you're really well lit. You have a nice Rembrandt with the shaping. I'm a little overlit today. I step back a little bit. I actually have a softbox up here and lights on either side. So it makes a difference. People really, you're not just hiding out in a cave somewhere. So many webcam things that it looks like they're literally, hiding out.
It does make a difference. And, not having this in the background, okay, I think also makes it a difference. And we talked about that. Not having this in the background also makes a difference. And it's really simple, you guys, to, let me come back to my tech space. It's really simple to take into consideration, do you have good audio? Is the lighting okay? If you're out at the beach or outside, make sure that the sun is at 45 degrees and facing you and not immediately behind you. When you're holding up your phone and you're shooting video, hang on, let me come back to you. Let me see. Okay. When you're coming, holding up your phone, look at what's in the background. And I did a video from the beach, I think three mistakes I see professionals make when shooting video. And I'm at a beautiful beach and I'm shooting the video on purpose. And I have one of those beach trash cans behind me, sitting up on the jogging trail. And I said, watch you guys, if I just pivot about 45 degrees and I pivot and there's the beautiful ocean. And so if you think ahead about, what's the experience, what's being consumed by all of the senses of your audience. And sometimes you want to use descriptive words to tell your audience that you're walking through a field of wildflowers and what it smells like as the sun's setting, and bring them into the picture just like we would in an opening statement or a closing argument.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean,
that's
Mitch,
what lawyers need to do.
Like I said, you and I have been in this long enough. We knew people who were skeptical of having a website, or skeptical of giving up on Yellow Pages. So if someone's watching this, maybe they're not as tech savvy as you are. They may be wondering, well, what does this have to do with getting cases? How do I connect the dots between video content and actually growing my practice?
Well, I think growing up in Tucson, Arizona, I did not know anybody in California. I graduated from the University of Arizona. Mike, just real quick story to answer your question. Yeah. Managed to turn a four-year degree at the University of Arizona into a five-year experience. And I wouldn't change that again. It was great. I grew up in Tucson, but I moved up to Lake Tahoe and helped open up Caesars Tahoe in their management department. Got in a couple of 50-day ski seasons, a couple of summers out on Lake Tahoe, sailboarding every single day from Ski Run Marina. And decided I didn't want to do that for the rest of my life as far as being in the hotel business, 18-hour days. If you're really good in the hotel business, they'd move you every 6 months to open up a new property. And came back to Tucson, studied for the LSAT. Long story short, moved out to California to go to law school. Didn't know anybody out here, okay? And I knew one person, but I slept on that family's couch for a couple of weeks until I found an apartment. But the way I built my practice from day one back in 1986 was through the relationships that I built. And what the mistake I made is my first 3 or 4 years of practice, I was going head to head with the big firms in town. And if you know Orange County, we have some very well-known trial lawyers here in Orange County that have had, national cases, right? Right. And I realized I didn't have the funds, the reputation, the brand to compete with these lawyers. If I kept doing the same old thing, showing up at the Bar Association meetings, placing an ad in the Yellow Pages back then, placing my ad in the Bar Association magazines, they were outspending me, 1,000 to 1. And it just wasn't going to happen. So here's what I started to do. I started hearing with the guys I played basketball with down in Laguna Beach, Main Beach every day. I started hustling them and sharing with them if they need a good lawyer, I'm their guy, and I keep passing them the ball and I keep helping them win games. Down at the motocross track, I grew up riding and racing motocross. I was a little bit more outgoing at the track about me being that lawyer down at Elsinore on Wednesdays and Saturdays. And what I noticed is people involved in those activities, they could care less about the big firms in town. They wanted someone who they could relate to, who they knew liked and trust back then.
Yeah.
And, you know, the light bulb went on and I started thinking to myself, wait a minute, let me just go ahead and embrace who I am, what my interests are. And what I found, Mike, is fast forwarding to social media, it allows you to do this at exponentially fast rate across multiple platforms. And while you and I back in the day might have been trying to develop referral relationships with someone across the street or someone on the other side of town, what social media has allowed me to do is create those same intimate personal referral relationships, not only in California, but across the country and across the world. Wow. And so this is something that I'm a firm believer in having an abundance mentality. There's plenty of people that need our help as lawyers. And the more lawyers who are leaders and come onto social media and take advantage of these platforms. If you're comfortable with video, embrace video, mobile video, unplanned, spontaneous video. I have a concept that I'm actually thinking about writing a book about, and it's called, it circles around intentional spontaneity. And what that is for the trial lawyers out there, you guys know that when you've got a witness on the stand, you don't need a handful of notes to effectively cross-examine that witness. You can rely upon your 20 or 30 years of experience having witnesses like that on the stand. You know what buttons to push. You know, based upon your jury selection, the theme, the flavor of the trial, and you just know what to do. Well, the same thing happens with social media. I don't want to see lawyers reading scripts, teleprompters, have some talking points, speak from the heart and connect with the audience. But if you're comfortable with video, do video. If you've got a great radio voice and you're more comfortable with podcasting, do a podcast. If you like to dance and you're good at entertaining and you're a funny lawyer, get on TikTok right now. I mean, there's a platform for everyone. And then once you push your comfort zone and you're on the major platforms, because I do think it's smart to be on all the major platforms, then learn how to repurpose your content. And that's what will save you a lot of time. What I mean by repurposing content is create content once and then repurpose it. If I create a video on YouTube, I might take bits and pieces of that video and share it on YouTube and LinkedIn and Instagram and TikTok. I might rip the audio from that video or have my team member do that and create little sound bites using Headliner or setting up a, and I can't say it too loud because she'll wake up, and Alexa flash audio. You guys know what I'm talking about. And so you want to build your brand on as many platforms as you're comfortable with doing. And if you don't have the time or energy, get other people to come in and help do it for you.
So I think, Mitch, we're recording this and we're going to put this out to social media. And what we'll try to do, if it's okay, is in the text below the video, list some of these, the eCam and the books you mentioned and these kinds of things for folks, if that's all right. In fact, I want to make sure I get them all. So I'm going to ask Amanda to transcribe all that and get those links for us so I can continue to improve. Let's talk about platforms. What are the important platforms to be on, do you think, for lawyers? And you know, but before I ask you that, let me back up one more. When you're creating video, is your audience other lawyers or potential clients or both?
Because I like to focus on talking about hobbies and interests and passions, as opposed to our personal injury and wrongful death cases, our business to business litigation cases. Look, I honestly don't think the consumer's too interested in what lawyers are putting out there on social media, generally speaking. But they are interested in that human being who happens to enjoy paddleboarding or happens to enjoy discussing politics, okay, or happens to be comfortable in the kitchen sharing a new recipe. For me, the human side of all of this is what connects us as human beings, what puts me top of mind with that neighbor next door whose best friend needs a lawyer. We get the referral because they're thinking about us. So my audience is generally anyone that's interested in what I happen to be talking about. And by doing that, it allows me to easily create content. It's like, mm-hmm. people go, what do you create content about? What do you talk about? Well, I talk about things that I enjoy doing. And it's not going to connect with everyone, but it's going to connect with an audience. And you want to think going deep on social media, not wide. It's not the number of followers that you have. It's the number of quality human beings that you're engaging with on a human level on a consistent basis. And I think that's the key that a lot of lawyers need to keep in mind. So I would just focus on creating content that you, excuse me.
Sure. Let's both take a drink.
I'm getting all choked up because I'm excited about this stuff.
You're that passionate.
I will tell you, here's a little secret. For everyone watching the live or recorded show, without hesitation, the most powerful thing we've done on social, this has brought in million-dollar cases. It has gotten me on stage at Tony Robbins the last couple of years in front of 2,000 people, spending $10,000 a ticket with David Merriman Scott, who's just a gifted marketer and speaker. And that is the concept of newsjacking. If you guys aren't newsjacking and using social media to amplify your newsjacking efforts, you're missing out. And newsjacking, like I mentioned, use this term earlier, two-edged sword. You want to make sure you're newsjacking correctly. What is newsjacking? Newsjacking is sharing your own unique take on a breaking news story. Mm. Adding that second paragraph, that third or fourth sentence to the story that maybe a reporter or the consumer hasn't thought about, that gives a unique take, maybe even a personal take on something that's happening. For example, I'm down running at Strands and I check my phone. I'm at the drinking fountain and the Bill Cosby case broke with the drugs and the drinks back in the day. And I remember looking at this, thinking to myself, you know, like, oh my goodness, this is not good. I had a daughter that was just starting school at UCLA, who, by the way, is now a lawyer up in Century City.
All right.
Yeah, and so this goes back a few years, but I remember immediately hopping on Periscope, which is a live video broadcasting platform, you guys, to Twitter. It's like Twitter Live, talking about, as a dad, as a California trial lawyer, I don't know what Mr. Cosby did or did not do. These are the charges that just dropped. And the allegations that just dropped. As a lawyer in California, if this happened to my daughter, let me tell you what civil and or criminal repercussions would be towards anyone that did this to a co-ed at UCLA. So I personalized it and shared the civil and criminal aspect of it. When I got into the office, probably an hour and a half, 2 hours later, I had 10 to 15 phone messages from reporters who I already had relationships with, many of them, because I've been doing this for a while, but who wanted to follow up with that California lawyer who they just watched on Twitter because they're looking for fresh takes on the social media platforms. Wow. That's newsjacking. You want to keep it positive. You don't really want to put anybody down, but you want to add a unique take or twist to what's being reported. That's the most powerful thing I've done. And when you share your newsjacking on social media, Mike, it can just explode, and that's what happened.
So did you call them all back?
Not all of them. I called back. So here's the other little secret that works well for us is when we do interviews, and look, after 34 years, I'm pretty selective about my time and who we represent and what calls I return. And I actually don't encourage young lawyers to do what I'm doing. I'm just at the point where that's just the way I roll. But I will tell you, when we have interviews and we try to add value with the reporters, what I'll normally ask them is, listen, the next time a story breaks on this topic, whether it's sports or business or tech or politics, you want me to reach out to you with my thoughts. And I've never had a reporter say no. We include that reporter in our database. And then when I do a take on, you know, that NFL quarterback that's been arrested for distracted driving and maybe hurting someone, and I'm a big advocate of, you know, not distracted driving, I'll send a blast out or a link to the video I just shot to that group of reporters who are interested in receiving an update on that particular subtopic. So that helps us with creating newsjacking content that gets picked up and then shared. And when I say shared, when I share this video on Twitter, someone will retweet that tweet, maybe their 350,000 followers. Someone will grab that link and share it on Facebook. Somebody on Twitter, on LinkedIn, will take and embed that tweet into their LinkedIn post or blog post. So it just starts taking on a life of its own. And for me, it's pretty exciting. I mean, I really like watching this stuff happen, especially if you're adding value with the content that you're creating.
You bet. Absolutely. Yeah. So that's what we've done a lot of, not newsjacking, but creating content to be helpful to folks. We don't create videos to try to sell our products or even really talk about us that much. We try to fill a huge gap in the world, I think, which is business and other training for plaintiff lawyers. You know, most plaintiff lawyers have undergrad in history, English, political science, sociology. They don't learn business in undergrad. They don't learn business in law school. And then sometimes all of a sudden they're a owner of a law firm. And so, you know, there's such a huge gap there. So we've really built our brand and reputation about just being there to help plaintiff lawyers, all of them, not just our customers. It's free, all the stuff we do. And it's been a game changer for us. So if you don't mind, for the folks who are not as, including me, not as social media savvy, Mitch, what are the platforms? You mentioned a few in passing, but what are the key platforms that a law firm should be on?
Well, I think video and live video is really important right now. There's a reason why Zoom has developed such a following over the last month and a half, right? And this is a platform we've been using forever. There's something about looking people in the digital eyeball. So I would say any platform that allows you to incorporate recorded or live video is very, very important if you want to build out your brand, if you want to connect, if you want to talk to potential clients in real time, right? So for me, the platforms that we use can all allow us to complement that platform using video. So I love Twitter. Twitter has allowed me to connect with people all over the world. And remember, we're talking multiple time zones as you go around the world. So, and that's another thing lawyers need to keep in mind is the content we're creating, it's global. And I love Twitter because it allows me to interact in real time with the world. It gives people access to me. It gives me access to them, private messaging, direct messaging on Twitter. Big fan of Facebook, whether you like Facebook or not. It's, you know, the most popular platform on the planet. Facebook groups, which you saw advertised during the Super Bowl. We saw that coming. We were talking about that a year ago in Facebook positioning towards groups, a more private, intimate community. Those are huge. LinkedIn's great. Instagram's popular. I'm having a lot of success on TikTok right now.
I'm not dancing.
I'm not juggling. Yeah, what I'm doing is I'm actually going on and sharing 60-second tips. My favorite trial. Hang on a second. I'm going to show you my favorite trial moment. My three things I learned in law school. Five tips for negotiating. It's kind of a business approach to TikTok. This is what it looks like, you guys.
Okay. I'll look at the screen now. I'm not supposed to.
Okay, and I'm getting a lot of play. Some of these have had, you know, hundreds of thousands of views. But the point is I'm not jumping up and down, singing and dancing. I'm just not good at that. But I am building out my own little niche on TikTok, and I call it the talk, just like Gary Vaynerchuk. If you look at Gary's TikToks, talking about business tips. And so lawyers can do the same thing. And there are some lawyers on TikTok that are doing a great job of showing their human side, of sharing what happened in court earlier in the day by singing to a video. Now that's not me, because I can't sing. I wish I could. If I did, I would. But there's all different types of ways to use these platforms. YouTube is huge. What I like as far as creating the content that we're talking about, you know, Mitch, you're doing videos. How are you creating the videos? Well, I use a couple of different platforms. We talked about Ecamm, which is actually Mac focused. And Mike, just so you know, Ecamm has a boot camp right now, today and tomorrow, where they've got 40 plus live video experts from all around the world. It's not just about Ecamm, it's about how to do live videos, and it's free. And I'm part of that, where I'm sharing the legal side of doing live video. If you're a business owner, what do you need to take into consideration when you go live, right? There's some business legal issues. But that's a great place if people want to learn about the details of doing live video. Right now, Zoom is something that we use each and every day to engage with our clients, to engage with our prospects, to do global broadcast. I'm doing a show Wednesday night for the first time on StreamYard, StreamYard. It allows you to do a show almost like a television show with a lower one third, with bringing in the overlays, with bringing guests in, with sharing your screen. It's a very dynamic platform. And the reason I'm using it Wednesday night is when I go live on StreamYard, guess what? It's not just going live to YouTube. It's pushing to Facebook. It's pushing to my Facebook group. It's pushing to Twitter. It's pushing to Periscope. It's pushing to LinkedIn. And it's taking all of the comments from all of those different platforms and bringing them back in into one thread on the right-hand side of my admin screen. So when I ask people for questions, it pulls in the questions from Twitter and Periscope and LinkedIn and Facebook and YouTube.
Oh my gosh.
It's pretty slick, and it's been around for a couple of years. This is the first time I'm using it Wednesday night. I played around with it. So if anyone wants to see me either succeed or crash and burn Wednesday night, go over to, well, I don't want to promote the show, but just find me on Wednesday night. And it kind of complements what you're doing here. What I did, just because we all have some extra time. And frankly, Mike, a lot of friends of mine are really well-known keynote speakers and marketing experts, right? There's no speaking gigs going on right now, right? So everyone's available to be a guest. And so what I'm doing is taking advantage of that. I'm bringing in these people on Wednesday nights, and I created a channel. It's Wednesday Night Legal Marketing Live. Basically, it's the live video show, just like what you and I are doing here. And I'm bringing in some of the top marketing and branding experts from around the world to show lawyers how to do it right, how to build relationships as opposed to market their practice. And so I'll be using StreamYard Wednesday night. We go live at 5 Pacific, 8 Eastern. And like I said, it's either going to be really, really awesome or it's going to be a train wreck. And I mean, but that's the mentality you have to have, because you know what? Who cares? Who cares? Either way, we're going to give it a shot. I think it's going to work out just fine. But that's a pretty cool platform your audience may want to take a look at.
I get too obsessed sometimes. You can ask my team about this, about every little detail and everything. And I think there is an expectation nowadays that, look, it's not going to be perfect. You're going to have earbuds in, and you're going to, you know, that's just the way the world works now. And so, I'm learning so much today. Amanda, I know you're on this with us. I hope you're taking notes. I got to check this stuff out. I want to tune in on Wednesday. So aren't you known as like the live video? Wednesday show already, or no?
Well, so I have a global mastermind for lawyers where I show lawyers how to do all this. Okay. And but I would say probably 4 or 5 years ago, I was down in San Diego at Social Media Day San Diego, which is put on by a friend of mine now. His name's Tyler Anderson. He has Casual Fridays. He does social media for large hotels, and also a very nice family in man. And I remember going down there and creating a free WordPress site, streaming.lawyer. And the reason I created the free WordPress site, streaming.lawyer, is I wanted to show young lawyers and young entrepreneurs how they can create and start their business for free, basically, right? Using Gmail and using a free WordPress site. And we had been live streaming for a while, but I didn't have a non-legal live streaming social media video blog. We just had our traditional website for personal injury and wrongful death cases. Yeah. So it's a completely different hat, right? And so we set up streaming.lawyer, which everyone can now go to if they go to mitchjackson.com. It's going to take you to the same place. We redirect URLs, you guys, to our websites and to our back pages. So Wednesday night, legalmarketing.live is a URL redirect to streaming.lawyer, just one of the back pages. Didn't cost anything extra. It didn't take any extra time. But the reason I set it up was to show young entrepreneurs how to do all this. Why was I down in San Diego? Why was I speaking at Social Media Day San Diego? I'm the only lawyer in the room on stage with perceived expertise and credibility in front of 400 entrepreneurs, many of which have started multi-million dollar companies with a couple of text messages or a couple of Twitter DMs. No paperwork, no legal entities, no business insurance, no HR department, right? So I'm there in front of this audience. That's why I take the time and trouble to do this. Now, I also love being around that young, energetic, you know, tech crowd. To me, it keeps me young. I love that stuff. Cool. And so what I've done the last couple of years is channel everything I'm doing down there and at all the social media events I speak at. I've spoken at Periscope Summit New York, Periscope Summit San Francisco, Periscope Summit LA, gotten to meet a lot of interesting people from around the world. But what I do is I bring them over to streaming.lawyer. They're not interested in the traditional web law firm website page. Now, the last couple of years, I've brought my kids down. So this past social media day, I brought my son Garrett, who is now 20, and he was a summer intern for Nimble. Nimble is a company that John Ferrara started, and it's a CRM, you guys, that allows you to take Mike's name and put it into Nimble, and it'll bring in all of his social media activity over the past week or two into the database. So you can see what Mike's been talking about and what's on his mind. I use Nimble when I'm picking a jury. I'll have my assistant sitting next to me and we'll Nimble the prospective jurors because I want to know what's on their mind. And it's pretty powerful. And I incorporate the results into my voir dire. So if someone's daughter just got done running cross country, my daughter ran cross country, during the conversation, I'll somehow bring that up and start developing rapport. It's, you know, the more information you have, and then if you go about it the right way, it could be valuable.
I'm sorry. You're telling the story. Go.
All I was going to say is I brought my son down with me last year, and I brought my daughter down, I think, the year or two before, because I wanted all of these young entrepreneurs to see my family, and I wanted them to meet who I was engaging with. So I'm all for social media, sharing your private life to the point that you're comfortable with doing so, and to the point where it's smart to do so, as opposed to personal addresses, phone numbers, things like that. I didn't mean to interrupt.
No problem. I was interrupting you actually, so I apologize. But because I'm watching the clock here, we only have about 15-ish minutes left. And what I want to say to the viewers is start asking questions if you like. Type them into the questions window, and we're having technical difficulties, so Amanda's going to have to chat with me to show me the questions, but don't wait. You can start typing those questions in as we see them come on. We want to make sure that if you have questions for Mitch, that we have time to get to those. You were talking about bringing your family into the thing. I think people can see through an insincere marketing attempt where maybe it's not even a lawyer. They've hired someone to do it, and I see, like, on Twitter, you know, they'll say horrible crash on I-5 and there's a picture of the lawyer smiling. You know, the context is just terrible. And there's so many people doing that wrong, you know.
It's, you know, I'll tell you what, my kids, when they were both in high school and in middle school, we were a sports family. And so we would always, you know, share team parties and put together those winning goals or touchdowns and just have fun with it, right? And what I found for lawyers on social media, Mike, is shining a light on other people. In other words, if you're not comfortable with being on social for whatever reason, you know what? Shine a light on your client's company and go in and interview them or show people how they put their products or services together or give them a shout out when they have a social media post. Share their post with your audience and just shine a light on other people. That's probably one of the best ways to, you know, to build your brand and be known.
That's a great point. And that's the other thing we do with social media. One of the things is we shine light on our clients. And I have actually a trademark on the term cases that made a difference. So we're creating a playlist on YouTube and also podcasts that highlight the important different changes that plaintiff lawyers make. Most people don't understand that, okay, someone's injured, they need to get some money for their injuries. That's fine. That's one of the things that people, that trial lawyers do. But they make the world a better place. They make it a safer place. They get bad actors off the street. They do so many things. So we're trying to just shine the light on the good things that plaintiff lawyers do. Because, you know, you have a bullseye on your back. No one's out to help plaintiff lawyers, right? There's all kinds of lawyer jokes and things like that.
Well, so it's all about telling stories. And there was a question I saw, is there eCAMS for Macs? And it is. For Windows-based programs, I believe ManyCam, if I'm not mistaken, M-A-N-Y-C-A-M. If I am mistaken, just message me and I'll share with you what the Windows platform is. Yeah, so it's all about telling stories from a genuine way, from the heart, stories where And that's the art of, I think, social media, Mike, is the lawyers understand it's not about talking about that accident on the I-10 freeway. It's about telling a story, an emotional story that has three components. And okay. Once again, this isn't planned, but it just happens to be on my screen. So I'm going to bring it up.
Oh.
Talk Like Ted by Carmine Gallo. Carmine is a friend of mine. He actually contributed a chapter to my book. Carmine interviewed you guys, I think it was the top 200 TED speakers. What do they have in common that makes them so darn persuasive when they're on stage? And when you guys are, and I suggest everyone get the book Talk Like Ted,
okay,
or read his chapter in my book. But what I was going to say is when you guys are on social media, when you're on video, live video, or you're creating written or podcast type of audio content, think about telling a story, okay? Use good storytelling techniques, emotion, being unique, sharing details, telling stories in a memorable fashion so that these will be remembered and understood and shared with other people. Use the five-step process to telling a good story. Number one, state the problem, but state it in a storytelling fashion. Take your time. Okay. Don't jump from one to five. Number two, agitate the problem. If we don't fix this problem, this is what's going to happen to Johnny next. If we don't fix this problem, this is what's going to happen next. Number three, state a clear and concise solution to the problem. Number four, show how your solution will help your audience of one, your audience of 12 jurors, or your audience of 1,000 people watching the webinar. And number five, some type of call to action. Call to action in court might be, this is what I want you to fill in on our jury verdict sheet. A call to action on social media might be a little bit less direct. If you guys want to stay in touch, if you like this topic, jump over to streaming.lawyer and let's keep the dance going. Hardcore calls to action do not work on social media, nor should they. So just use these approaches, and I think you'll be way ahead of all the other lawyers trying to do social media.
Yeah. Well, I want to apologize for a technical difficulty on our end. I can't see the question box. Can you see the questions, Mitch?
I'm looking. You know what? I think I can. So let me take a look real quick. So I was looking at the chat, not the questions, but let me see. Mac users, I'm just looking at the chat, but no, I don't see.
Well, Amanda's monitoring it. She'll chat with us if there are any coming in.
Do you mind if I jump in and just tell you one of the biggest mistakes I see lawyers making with video and live video? Because I think it's really important. And you started this webinar off, this show off the right way. I mean, you did.
Okay,
you
good.
Right to
I was afraid you're going to tell me all the mistakes I made.
Here's the thing. It's like knowing how to use Twitter or video or live video. That's one, you know, knowing how to use the platforms. That's one thing. But here's the thing. When you do a video or go live, immediately dive into your content, immediately grab the attention of your audience. 100 years ago, the average attention span was about 20 minutes. Today, some experts are saying it's about 8 to 9 seconds, the same attention span as a goldfish. Now, I don't think that's true. I have young Gen Y and Gen Z kids, and I think they have great attention spans as long as they're interested in what they're being asked to pay attention to. So you have to capture attention. And with video and live video, you guys, start off by asking questions. Once you go live, it's going to take a few minutes for people to find your stream and come in. Okay, so while they're finding your stream and coming in, don't just say, listen, we're going to sit tight until everybody gets here. What time is it? Hey, they'll be here in a few minutes. Start the conversation off. This is why I'm going live today, you guys. Here's the problem. Here's something I see everybody having a challenge with. How are we going to fix it? I'm going to tell you exactly in three steps how we're going to fix this. It's the why, who, how, and what if. What if you don't fix this problem? What's going to happen? All right, it's been a couple of minutes. Everyone's here. Let's dive in. So that's a great way to start off your live videos. The other thing is, as a lawyer, don't spend a lot of time talking about your credentials, your accomplishments. Nobody cares. Okay, your audience is there to get value. So what you want to do is start off immediately with an answer to an important question, something that grabs them right away, like you would in a good opening statement. That first 2 minutes, I take my jury back in time. They're standing on the corner, watching and listening to that 1962 Mustang drive by at 80 miles an hour, looking up at the red light and watching the vehicle fly through the intersection, but it doesn't make it because it hits the station wagon, you know, full of a family of six. I watch the vehicles collide, flip upside down. I smell gasoline and I can see the fire, you know, and then let's come back today. That's why we're here. This is what the evidence is going to show. By capturing your audience's attention on social media in the first couple of minutes, you're creating a good first impression. You're creating attention. People are going to share your content even before they watch it. Ooh, this is good stuff. And guess how many lawyers do you guys know that are doing that? If you're doing things like every other lawyer in town, you're doing it the wrong way on social media. And I say that with love. I married a lawyer. We met in law school, 32 years. My daughter's a lawyer. I love lawyers. But I'm just saying, don't look at what all the other lawyers in town are doing. Be different on social. And that's how you can stand out.
Yeah, I think it goes back to their undergrad, right? They didn't study marketing. They didn't study these kinds of things. And suddenly they're a business owner and they have to market themselves. And a lot of times they don't know where to start. So, well, viewers, if you're trying to put in questions, I'm not sure what's up, they're not coming through, feel free to email your questions and we'll to the link that you had in to the webinar. It's marketing@advocatecapital.com. And we'll be sure to compile those, get answers, and we'll do an email blast to you all later with the questions and answers on that if you're not getting through, because for some reason I'm not seeing any, which is pretty unusual. I'm sure I know I have a million questions.
I was gonna say that's not even a challenge. Can I ask you a question, Mike?
Sure.
So being on social media, you said I think you jumped on around 2011, 2012, either personally or through your company. What has been some of your favorite experiences, whether it's personal or business, using social media? I mean, any stories that you can share that might, you know, give us all a little bit of motivation to keep pushing forward right now?
Well, I think it's something that's good and bad. I'm a very private person, just naturally. My personality, I'm an introvert. My idea of recharging my batteries is to sit and read a book. You know, that gets me going, and not a cocktail party. So I'm not that kind of person. So I think what it's done for me is I've met so many people around the country and become friends with them. I never would have done that. I have a small circle of friends and family, and it's gotten me out. And then when I go out, people just walk up to me and we become friends, you know, even though all we did was see each other on social media. And one other thing that I think has been good is what you said about shining the light on other people. It has been so much fun, right? So I've been at a trade show watching a speaker who is a lawyer. I might not even know him, but I'll maybe take a picture. Hey, having a great time. Listen to Seth Price deliver some really great content. I'll post it and tag him. And I've had folks I've never known before really come up to me a year later, 5 years later, and say, you know, when you shared that video or that picture of me, I noticed that and that meant so much. So it's really actually become social for me in areas I never would have done, you know.
I'll second that. I'm kind of an introvert too. This whole social distancing thing, I've been actually
practicing. You don't seem like it.
I know that. But I would prefer to be home with my family than out at bar association meetings. And that's why I like social so much. I've been practicing social distancing for 25, 30 years. All right. So this is nothing new to me. but what you just said is so important. It's, you know, telling stories is what connects us all on social media. I think in life, and if you're not comfortable with telling a story about yourself or something that you did, then tell a story about someone else, okay?
Whether
or a customer or highlighting someone on stage. And if you're not, for whatever reason, comfortable with doing that, tell a story about a company, about a public, something that's happening in the news, about someone who you would like to meet. And talk about their experiences. There's so many different ways to share stories. You know, hey, Mike, just real quick over on the comments, I see a comment about social brand building. Is that different than using lead generation services? I get bombarded with sales pitches for lead generation. So I just cannot stand cold calls. I cannot stand people reaching out to me, just so you guys know, in an email or a text or a video, whatever you want to call it, in a cold call. Okay, that doesn't work for me. I'm all about relationships. I don't see the two as having anything in common. In other words, what I'm doing is creating a digital brand, and what I've done that hopefully will allow some people to know, like, and trust me, and I'm adding value. And I know that's the case because they're reaching out and they're telling us that. On the other side of the coin, I'm fairly opinionated. That's why I became a trial lawyer. Everyone doesn't have to do this. I became a trial lawyer because I wanted to take on the bullies in the world. I wanted to take on the wrongdoers in the world. I'm the first lawyer in my family. I'm the first person in my immediate family to go to college, right? Wow. And I grew up with a certain mentality. And so when you follow me on social, you know where I stand on all these issues. I don't recommend everybody doing that, but that's me. That's my core. Yeah. That's who I am. And for every person that has unfollowed me for something I've said, I've gotten 100 other people that have followed me. And real interesting, Mike, a few years ago, I was down at an event in San Diego listening to Guy Kawasaki speak on stage. And if you guys don't know Guy Kawasaki, he's probably one of the most well-known brand ambassadors and influencers on the planet. He was sitting next to Steve Jobs during the iPhone development. Really cool dude in his mid-60s, Hawaiian surfer dude living in California. He's on stage talking about politics, and he's on stage talking about he felt like he needed to say something, and I'm not going to get into specifics, but his friends were saying, if you do this, guy, and here's someone that gets 30,000 new followers a month on LinkedIn, 30,000 a month new followers on LinkedIn. If you say this, it's all going to fall apart, right? And he goes, man, I can't take this anymore. I have to say something. So that's what he does. He takes a position and he shows the next slide, which is a chart, and it goes down to zero. And you hear the audience, like 500 people in the audience, just go, oh, that's really sad. And Guy looks up, he goes, no, man, that's not what happened. And he shows the next slide, and of course it doubles. It doubles, right? And the point of this, and I remember talking to him at lunch about this, and I said, it was interesting to share this because that's kind of what I've experienced too. The point being is be yourself, be true to what you believe, share from your heart on social media, just like you would in court during an opening statement or a closing argument, and add value. And don't ask anyone for anything on social media. Just keep giving and giving and giving. And then when you do need something, it's going to be there. If you need to reach out for help, and you do publicly or privately, that help will be there. And it's just been a great way, Mike, after, you know, like I said, 34 years of practicing law, these last 20 have been so exciting because of the website and blogging and now social media and digital.
Yeah.
I'm more excited today to get up out of bed and go into the office and practice law than I've ever been in my life. And I don't know many lawyers that have been practicing for 3 decades that can honestly say that. And it's because of everything that we talked about. So I'm hoping that my enthusiasm, my approach is going to rub off, especially on lawyers right now that have a little extra time to learn some of the platform. Right? This is a great time to dive in. And if anyone has any questions, I'm not selling anything. I'm just selling being high on life, you guys. I mean, honestly. And
let me go ahead and put up your contact info, Mitch. Hopefully, is that showing? Yes, it should be up now. So this is Mitch, a couple of URLs. I'm sure they can follow you and get in touch with you at those URLs as well. And you're right about lawyers not being excited to get out of bed in the morning, because one of the most popular webinars I do is how does a law firm partner retire from a contingency law practice? Very popular topic.
I get it, you know, I get it, but I'm one of those guys that will probably never retire. I just enjoy helping people. Yeah, so
I don't know what I do.
That's my MO, you know?
If anybody wants to reach out to me, this is my contact info if you'd like a copy of my book. Mitch, what is the name of your book? You just mentioned it.
So my book is The Ultimate Guide to Social Media.
Awesome.
And it was an Amazon bestseller in 2 different categories. And the reason I can hold this up and not feel guilty for holding it up is I actually reached out to 46 top experts from around the world to contribute chapters on the platforms that they're experts in. Yeah. And so I've got yours. Yeah, you've got a deal. It would be my pleasure. But all I was going to say is the third section of the book, the first section, I know you want to wrap this up. And the first section is about having the right social media mindset. If you don't have the right mindset, this isn't going to work. And we talked about the mindset today of giving. Number two, you have to understand the personalities of the platforms. And we talked about that. Number three, my favorite section of the book is all about communication. Things we've picked up, people we've met over the years that are communication experts, they've shared chapters on how to take those techniques onto the digital platform. So even if you're not interested in social media, that third section on communication, which is 15 plus chapters, is something that's one of my favorite pieces of work, because I brought in everyone else to crowdsource the topic that I've ever been a part of. So thanks for asking, because it's been fun to put together.
Yeah, my idea for my next book is going to be called Cases That Made a Difference. And I'm going to invite my trial lawyer friends to come in and write a chapter each, right? So I'll do the intro. Are you in? Okay.
I've got two. And that's just it, Mike. When you say something like that, it like brings back memories. It's like, what a pleasure to be able to make a difference in a particular family's life, right? So.
Right. Awesome. Well, hey, Mitch, what an incredible hour of content. It's amazing. I know our viewers have loved it. I'm sorry we can't get to all the questions. We will gather those questions. You'll get an email with a link to a video of this interview today, and it will have a lot of the links to things Mitch was talking about, contact information and things like that. And if there are other questions, we'll get like a Q&A section in that email so you can see that. Mitch, thank you so much for your time today. I loved it. I enjoyed it so much. And we should do this again. I'll send you my book.
I'd love to. I'll send you my book. Mike, thanks. Thanks, everybody, for joining us. Appreciate it. Make today your masterpiece.
Thank you all. Thank you all for joining us.